off the assembly line. Made by batteries of machines representing big investments of capital, and all helping to raise standards of living. Britain is already investing vast sums of money, one-fifth of her national output each year, in new plant and new factories. Produce more by helping their workpeople to make better use of the existing machinery and manpower. Higher production can be achieved by the simplest improvements in methods of work that help to save a lot of human effort and time and money and provide a larger pay packet. Packing a gear with grease is still human handiwork, done in the old way. A simple improvement. An adaptive grease gun does it in one operation. Again the old way. Time wasted putting on the lid. But with the new grease gun, the cover remains on the whole time. One cement mixer. A lot of men and barrows. One man minding the mixer. Of course, it'd be much better with just one cement dumper instead of the barrows, because it sets five men free to take more skilled work on the same job, building more homes, taking home more pay. Handling again, handling metal rods, bending and stretching day after day. Save effort, reduce costs, do it by gravity. And a bright idea. Bright ideas are the signposts to higher productivity, better standards of living. The man on the job is as likely to have a bright idea as anyone else. He knows his job. In an old shipyard, now converted to a factory, the making of foundry boxes for casting is heavy work. Welding different parts onto them. Turning. Turning, more movements of the human hand than of machinery. One of the men had a bright idea, which he talked over with a welder, who told him to put it before the works committee meeting. It struck both the management and the other workers as a bright idea, and practical. The new turntable frame holds and turns the job. It's called a manipulator. Something that acts instead of a human hand and saves effort. Anyway, one welder is pleased with one inventor. A bright idea is certainly worth something extra in the pay packet. But it means that instead of 900 foundry boxes a month, they now make 1,000. More sales, more exports all over the world. Among British exports for dollars are her famous hand-block printed textiles. High-quality hand craftsmanship. But what did it mean? Great skill, certainly. But a lot of unnecessary and tiring movements. All of them different, yet all of them repeated. Can't the management and the work study expert, with the help of the skilled printer, do something better between them all? One of their problems was the waste of time and effort when the hand printer got to the end of the piece. He and his assistant had to get the ink and blocks round to the other side of the cloth and then work back. The expert had the idea. But first they consulted the trade union to make sure that their interests would be safeguarded. And the expert also came along to show them what his idea would really mean and to ask them all to give it a trial. A simple straddle trolley with a sliding tray. Scarcely an expensive piece of new capital equipment. Result? A 20% increase in the printer's output. And to lighten the handling of the heavier blocks, the expert suggested a spring counterbalance. Narrow gangways. Old looms. The weaver's shuttle is as old as the Old Testament. Old ways of kissing the shuttle. Some of the finest cotton cloths in the world come from sheds in Lancashire. But there are still idle looms when the weaver works only four of them at a time. What can be done about it? Unskilled work, like oiling, can be done for the weaver. And skilled help can be given to her in case of a breakdown. Then there are new ways of winding on the weft. And new bobbins. Again, weft can be brought to the weaver. And she can use a larger shuttle, easier to thread. Trade unions agree to improvements that help people to earn more money by using machines more productively, so that a weaver can work not four, but eight looms. But some things are made by people without any machinery. What about trying to decorate 1,200 Christmas cakes for a rush order? That's when a manager gets worried. If the orders aren't done by Christmas, it's a dead loss. So he calls in a consultant. Can we save the two decorators time and effort without lowering the quality? Hand in the jam operation. Hardly skilled work. And then on to rolling out paste. Then crimping the marzipan with only one hand. So the trickier job, the decorating, gets held up. To the expert observer, a jam brush is the idea. Use separate girls to put the marzipan on, and use two hands for crimping it. Before it goes to be decorated, the consultant uses the assembly line method, though there are no machines. And for rush orders, he brings in unskilled workers from the bakery to leave the decorators free for the job that only they can do. So they make 1,200 cakes in 3 days instead of 3 weeks. Pottery, like the weaver's shuttle, is as old as the Old Testament. And it's still handiwork. The eyes and hands of potters are still vital in Britain's famous china and porcelain factories. All types of ware are made, from the best handwork to what we all use in our kitchens. Standardized and mass-produced. Making high-quality figures for ornamenting, one by one, is certainly handiwork. So is rubbing on the transfer designs. And enameling them. Skill and mass production side by side, in a modern factory. Where you might not think efficiency could be raised any further. But look inside again. Here the trained eye can observe crowded work. One skilled man taking work from women who are preparing it for him. All working at different speeds. And gaps when he waits for work or it piles up. Time and effort wasted moving around, fetching and carrying, all interrupting his real job. So they decide to try a separate room for the women who do the figure making. They can work steadily and continuously, and so provide a flow of work for the men without worrying about each other's output. Fewer people moving around, and fetching and carrying is also specially done for both the figure makers and the ornamenters. The observer also watched the preparing and rubbing on of designs, where again he saw a waste of time. And of effort. Idle hands waiting for work. He rearranges the girls. Some actually prefer to stand up to work. And again he uses the assembly line method. And instead of that rubbing on by hand, he suggests an autoclave, as it's called. Not expensive, really, just a big household pressure cooker, which uses a steam pressure to force on the design, with a big saving of time and effort. And lastly, the specialist had a look at the enameling room. Piles of work waiting for skilled hands. Reach out for fresh work, while the other is drying. Another bottleneck. Get up. Disturb everybody. And take the completed work off to the firing ovens. The observer's idea was quite simple. Rearrange the girls again in the same room and put in specially built tables that revolve to bring up and move on the work. Through these improvements, the men and women have increased their output by as much as one-fifth and increased their earnings by up to 30 shillings a week. These are real improvements, like the other examples. They're true stories which emphasize a general principle. The hands and eyes of the skilled worker must be freed from unnecessary labor. The delays, obstacles, inefficiencies, and bottlenecks, not so obvious until the camera picks them out, can be abolished by bright ideas and work study. Higher productivity means that with less time and effort, more goods are produced at lower costs with higher earnings. That benefits everybody.